Hey, welcome back. This is Asfar Basunia, and I'm a final year medical student who matched here for diagnostic radiology. In this video, I'm going to share with you how I approached filling out my ARIS application. I've made a separate video for both the ARIS personal statement as well as the virtual interview process. Links are in the description down below. Now, when you log into ARIS, you will see six distinct tabs. The dashboard is like your homepage. The application tab is what we will talk about in this video. In the documents tab, you will upload your personal statements, assign letters of recommendation, and upload additional documents. In the programs tab, you will search, save, and apply to your residency programs. The message center acts as your email and communication hub with your residency programs. And finally, the interviews tab, where you can accept and schedule interviews for programs that are using the ARIS scheduler. Now, unfortunately, I cannot show you how my application looks like in the ARIS portal because as soon as I submitted my application, the only modifiable thing that is available is the personal information. Fortunately, the AAMC provides an ARIS applicant worksheet which mimics the actual application, which I have filled out and will go through with you in this video. The first section of your application is personal information. My advice would be to create a separate email account solely for the purpose of ARIS and setting a special ringtone while enabling push notifications. This is because programs will use this email address to communicate with you and invite you to interviews. In the match information subsection, you can provide your NRMP ID as well as your partner's NRMP ID if you plan to couples match. If you don't have your NRMP ID yet, you can still turn in your application and add the number later on in your application. In the additional information subsection, you have to put in your USMLE ID as well as your ACLS, PALS, or BLS status as well as expiration dates. Now, I put no on being certified in PALS and BLS because I actually never did PALS certification and my BLS expired. Next, you will answer whether you are part of the Honor Society's Sigma Sigma Pi, Golgi Humanism, and AOA. Everything up to this point will remain editable in the ERAS portal even after you turn in your application. Next, we have questions on race and ethnicity, language, military information, and finally, hobbies and interests. Your hobbies and interests is an important subsection, especially if you're applying to radiology. When you write about your hobbies and interests, it is important to succinctly include any supportive statements on your level of involvement and any interesting tidbit you may have. So for instance, I loved watching movies, so I came up with an interesting tidbit about my favorite film era. If you also like watching films, you may have a favorite director, genre, or film style. If you like video games, maybe you have a favorite gaming genre or game publisher. If you like to cook, what sort of food do you like to make? If you like gardening, what is your favorite plant? I have been asked about my hobbies in all of my interviews, many agreeing with my choice of great films. Since I also mentioned that I like Bethesda software games, one interviewer even asked me if I preferred Fallout over Skyrim. If you have multiple hobbies like me, you can number them in your application. But as you can see, I didn't, and it worked out fine. Next, you have the education section, where you will fill out information on your undergraduate, graduate, and medical education. Then, you have professional membership. You can be a little creative here and state how you are involved with the organization and if you held any leadership positions. I just chose to list them and they were never brought up in my interviews. For the awards section, you can create a numbered list in chronological or reverse chronological order and include the criteria for selection and an award amount if applicable. The way I chose to represent my awards was to first include the award name, followed by the year, and then the amount in parentheses, and then finally a brief description or the criteria for selection. I'm providing two examples here, one of them with a monetary amount. In my first example, I received the Dean's Letter of Commendation in the year 2020. It didn't have any monetary amount, so I didn't include it, and it was given to me for having a superior academic standing defined by having at least 4 honors in clinical core rotations. Another award I received from the university was in 2019 for $5,000, which I included in parentheses. It was awarded to me because I was in the top 50% of my class with financial need. You can use the same format for non-medical school awards as well. How far back you go in the awards section is up to you, but there is a 510 character limit. Next, we have the experience section. In the first part, we're asked about any clinical training experience in either ACGME or AOA accredited residencies or fellowships. If you are a fourth year medical student like me, you'll choose none and move on. Next, you'll describe your volunteer, research, and work experiences. This is an important section that will distinguish you from the other candidates who may have similar backgrounds, board scores, and clinical grades. Thus, judicious formatting and being succinct with details are absolutely key to make this section stand out. Here are two examples. First, I described a volunteer experience in my medical school where I was the co-founder and co-president of a refugee wellness group. In the description, I included the mission of the organization, which was to connect medical students and residents to the surrounding refugee communities. And I also described a notable activity or accomplishment my refugee wellness group was able to carry out. Second, I described a notable research experience in the Department of Medical Genetics at my medical school. In the description, I noted what I did for the research experience and the outcome of this research experience. So in this case, I wrote down that I was collecting and analyzing clinical course of seizures as well as the response to various anti-seizure treatments in children with GABRB2 gene mutations. And this research project resulted in one institutional as well as one national conference poster presentation. A few important things to note here. Number one, ARIS will automatically arrange your activities within a specific section in chronological order. Number two, use the last sentence of your description to state if you received any competitive grants in your club or activity, or if you were able to present your research as a poster or an abstract at any conference. Number three, try to stay away from writing long paragraphs. Instead, break up your description into succinct sentences or bullet points. Number four, it is not necessary to mention the average number of hours per week or reasons for leaving for all activities. Number five, it is more important to focus on the quality over the quantity of activities. Thus, the amount of description you put down for a particular activity should be directly based on the emphasis you want the interviewer or the selection committee to notice. Number six, some things may fall under multiple categories, such as work and research experience. It does not really matter how you classify them. Next, we have a section to discuss any interruption in your medical education from leave of absence to gap years. Now, if you have a gap in your medical education, the length of explanation will probably depend on your specific reason. So, if you took time off to pursue an MPH, other advanced degrees, or research years for a competitive specialty, you probably won't need to write as much as you have to if you took the leave of absence for academic probation. Then, we have questions about licensure and other legal stuff like felony convictions or misdemeanors. if you're a fourth year medical student like me, you have no state licensure and you are not board certified. Now, moving along to another important section, your publications. Publications can fall under multiple categories. Let's start with published manuscripts. First, you write the title of your manuscript or abstract, followed by the authors. For the authors, you start with the last name of the author, followed by the first and the middle initial, and you separate the author names with an ampersand. Unfortunately, there is a character limit to the author box, and thus, if you're like me and you're in the middle of a sea of authors, you may run out of character limit by the time you get to your name. In that case, I put the first two authors followed by dot dot dot, then my name in all caps followed by dot dot dot, and then the last two authors. Putting my name in all caps makes it stand out a bit. Then we have the publication name followed by the PubMed ID, publication number, issue number, pages, month and year, all of which can be found from PubMed. Moving on to unpublished work. First, I listed the title of the project. For the authors, I wanted to draw attention to the fact that I was a co-first author in the manuscript, and thus I put an asterisk after the name of all the first authors, and next to my name, I made sure to mention explicitly that I was a co-first author. In the publication status, I put accepted and the month and year it was accepted in. If you're applying to radiology like me and you have articles that are either under review or accepted in RSNA case collection or ACR case endpoint, I put them under this subsection as well. A few important things to note here. Number one, ARIS will automatically arrange your publications based on the last name of the first author. Number two, as I've demonstrated here, you cannot and do not have to put down the names of all of the authors for a particular work. Number three, if you are co-first authors or co-second authors, make sure to mention it in the author box. Number four, if you have scientific work that has been submitted to online-only publication that has not been accepted yet, you can put them under unpublished manuscripts section. Again, in this worksheet, I'm only showing a few examples. In the actual ARIS portal, you can add a lot more entries. As you complete your application, make sure you save your application and look at the PDF version of your application under view/printmyapplication or view/printmyCV to make sure that the formatting is coming out properly. Once you certify and submit your application, you cannot modify the application any further other than those in your personal details. That's it for today's video. Please help us out with the YouTube algorithm by liking, subscribing, and clicking the bell icon. If you have any topics that you want me to cover in future videos, please leave a comment down below. Until then, stay well and see you next time.